This is Steve Zeltzer with No Nukes Action, and I want to thank you all for joining us this evening in the West Coast and in the morning in Japan. And we have guests from both Japan and the United States to talk about the situation in Fukushima, the Olympics, the health issues, and the development of the Olympic in Los Angeles. So thanks for joining, and my co-host is Tsukuru Forrest, who is going to introduce our first guest from Fukushima, and following that we'll have Sarah and then Navin and George and George Wright, and then Navin Gordon, and then George Wright, and then we'll have a discussion and questions. And I want to thank first of all say that it's a propitious night that the Trump has been and his gangsters have been voted out. He says he wants to stay in the White House, but I doubt that that's going to happen. But who knows? You know, he's afraid if he goes out of the White House, he may end up in jail with him and his family. So, but I would say that the denialism of Trump of the COVID crisis is very much connected to the denialism of the Abe government, the Fuga government, about the nuclear dangers and the fact that the people can overcome radiation, don't have to worry about radiation. There's a connection between what is going on in the United States in the ruling classes and what is going on in Japan presently. So we could make those connections and talk about how we can unite our struggles both in the United States and Japan together against nuclear power, against radiation, and against more Fukushimas in the United States and around the world. So thanks for joining us. And Tsukuru, you want to start the first panel?
I'll be just brief. Hi, my name is Tsukuru, and I organize a group called Pacific Asian Nuclear Free Peace Alliance here in LA, California. And so this is very exciting because we have a very good panelist today. And joining us from Fukushima, actually, is Hiroko Aihara. She's an independent journalist, native of Fukushima, but she resides both in Fukushima and Tokyo nowadays, and she's been covering the issue of nuclear crisis in Fukushima ever since 2011. So she has some very important insights that she can give us about the current states in Fukushima and as it relates to the Olympics. So yeah, so please, Aihara-san, go ahead and start.
Hello, it is okay. My name is Hiroko Aihara. I'm an independent journalist, as Tsukuru-san introduced me. So I was born and raised up but in Fukushima and working a local newspaper for 20 years. So after March 11, I covered many stories, especially very local people's viewpoints, then how people are suffering and fighting and standing out, something like that, so them covering a story. Today, I would like to speak briefly to raise the issue for your discussion. So I'm now in front of the Great East Japan Earthquake and the Nuclear Disaster Museum in Futaba Town. Here, roll up my camera 360 degrees. You can see the, can you see the black box? It's a cleanup soil. Put it on black box on the hill, the ground. And there are no high buildings. Before March 11 in this area, we can see the, some building and houses, but the tsunami disaster brush off and destroyed the people's living life. First of all, here is about 28 kilometers far, about 175 miles far from Tokyo. So in this archive center was built in September this year, and the center named Nuclear Disaster Memorial Archive Center. So this center is a facility where many people evacuated due to the nuclear power plant accident and the situation of radiation exposure is presented with the budget of the national government of Fukushima Prefecture and carried down to future generations. So, I'm reporting from here now, from in front of this Senate. The Japanese government, especially from the viewpoints of the current looting political coalition of the Liberal Democratic Party and the new Komeito Party, this has maintained a close relationship with the hosting of the Tokyo Olympics. Now in Fukushima, it will be past about 10 years in next year, but it is taking destruction, creation, and conservation activities at the same time. Something is destroyed, something will be remained, something will be changed. So it is easy to remote under the big events, big national and big international events. In Olympic Games in Tokyo, what should be destroyed? We should ask ourselves, what should be destroyed and what should be left behind in this nuclear stricken area, and what is destroyed and what is left? The timing of destruction of the timing of preservation are closely linked to the reconstruction Tokyo Olympics. Tokyo Olympic Games names as a reconstruction Olympic game. The torch relay is scheduled in the nuclear affected area in Fukushima Prefecture by the nuclear Fukushima Prefecture. So I like to say it's truly national policy showcase Olympic game torch in Fukushima. Brush off the dark image. Blow off the nuclear health issues. So many people are excited and forget and the fun time, forget during the fun time. So immediately after the nuclear accident, J-Village means the national soccer, national athletic game points. It's a starting point in Japan, Tokyo Olympic Game. Torch run will be starting from the J-Village. So J-Village becomes a base for the destruction workers for the nuclear accident. A radiation screening center was set up for many workers. That is a true and actual happened, but and I think a lot of good stories will be told at the Tokyo Olympic game, during the Tokyo Olympic game. It's a beautiful story. Many workers saved the people's life, but we have to understand, I'd like to introduce the another side, dark side stories. This J-Village was one of the symbolic buildings that Tokyo Electric Power Company distributed the money to local government and local people like Fukushima Prefecture and other local government. So local government also accepted the money in order to promote regional development. That is so make it easier for local residents to accept nuclear power plants or not to oppose them, shut down their criticizing. There is such a dark side story in it. I would like to introduce another torch site, the Tanashio area on the border between Namie Town and Minami Soma City. Tanashio area is also a torch running area in Fukushima. There was, before March 11, about 20 or 30 years ago, there was a strong protest movement by local residents because the Tohoku Electric Power Company tried to build a new nuclear power plant. It is a place where the anti-nuke power farmers trust movement occupied the the local farmer pay much money to occupy the their farming area to refuse to sell the nuclear power plant company. But after March 11, this place was chosen for the torch relay course. This is where the nuclear power plant was going to be built, and there is a now. So in that area was settled a drone airfield and the hydrogen energy plant. So it is okay to very quick talk. It's okay, everyone.
Yes.
大丈夫ですか？ちょっと早かった？
いやいやいや、大丈夫だと思います。あの、いや、そう、
だ、まだ、いや、もうちょっと続けちゃっていいですか？そしたら。
もうちょっと大丈夫です。はい、ありがとうございます。Yeah, thank
you. Oh, sorry, I will continue. So we'll land the short at airfield runway of the drone test course and take about the areas running is just one about 2 meters. Then finished and warped to another side of the torch running and just a very short area we're running and finish and move to another area. So I think that this facility will be shown on the television broadcast of reporting this at a time rather than building being impressed by the fact that our drone is being trained in Fukushima. It's a very wonderful thing. And we are also developing hydrogen energy facilities. We shouldn't forget that drone and in September 7, 2013, in Buenos Aires, former Prime Minister Shinzo Abe determined the Tokyo Olympic by saying and inviting speeches.
It's breaking up. Maybe we can, if she's near a car or something, she might be able to.
Aihara-san.
もう終わりですね。
あの今ちょっとなんていうかな、30秒40秒くらい聞こえなくなっちゃったんですね、実は。
どうですか、これは。
あ、うん、それベターです、ベターです、はい。
OK、じゃああと2分ぐらいですぐ終わります。
はい、
はい。So, in his speech to the Olympic bid in Buenos Aires, Argentina, on September 7th, 2013, Prime Minister Shinzo Abe determined the Olympic Games or inviting Olympic Games by saying the situation at the nuclear power plant is under control and by claiming that Japan is going on the processes of reconstruction from the tsunami, earthquake and the nuclear accident, and that the Tokyo Olympics so then they named the Tokyo Olympic Games a reconstruction Olympic as a tool to complete the reconstruction. However, but immediately after the nuclear accident, it was reported that the reactor building was broken and the contaminated water was leaking into the ocean, and it became the in addition, in 2013, the contamination work, it's a cleanup operation on the soil, started in the living area, residents on the land side or farming side, and the environmental pollution, but at the time, environmental pollution is still existing. Of course, now it's still existing environmental contamination, but very few comments current situation. So we have to know that the opposite is happening behind beautiful and moving things. Someone who fails to win behind the scenes of the victory, a person who dies behind the living. I think we should not forget that we should not forget that there are people who were damaged by nuclear power plants, nuclear power plant accident and the tsunami. I'm closely watching how the destroyed town where many people have been evacuated due to the nuclear power plant accident, exploded the nuclear power plant facilities. So that is also we have to considering about many people are suffering from the big events. So Tokyo Olympic Games were used by the brush off systems, and many people should be forget the miserable situation by the government sectors or international propaganda network of the building Japanese people will say the nuclear village people or safety myths creating the sectors. So, but I think the people to people communication and the people's chain, that is a lie. So we have to build a trustable network between the people to people and Japan and United States and other countries. Thank you very much. So that's all my comments from the current situation in Fukushima and the Tokyo Olympic Game torch learning situation. 以上です。すみません。
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Thank you so much, Aihara-san. Yeah, so she was with us from Fukushima, as I said, and we kind of asked her the last minute to come on so that she can provide some context. So unfortunately, she won't be able to do Q&A today. She will have to leave this location to her job. So yeah, but thank you so much, Aihara-san.
ありがとうございます。Thank you very much. Thank you very much. つくさん、後でもしも、I wish you the to the participants if you have, if someone had questions, please, つくさん share another people my email address.
Yes.
ありがとう。Thank you very much. ごめんなさいね。今日は本当、なんかバーって。
いえいえ、とんでもないです。
ありがとうございます。Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I'm grateful that for that contribution.And our next speaker is going to be Sarah Yamasaki. She's a journalist from Tokyo, independent journalist, and has been active in the covering these issues, as well as the role of the Japanese government. And also she lived in New York for some time.
Hi, everybody. I'm reporting from my office in Tokyo, locating only 3 minutes walk from the newly built National Stadium.I can see the stadium itself from my window here. And it has so much concession, Olympic concession, including a new Prime Minister Suga. He has three sons, a grown-up son, and one of his sons works for Taisei Construction Company, who is the sole constructor.Of this national stadium. And this Taisei Kensetsu is owned by Bechtel, the huge giant construction company in the United States. So from the beginning of his administration, started only 2 months ago, he has so much scandals related to such a concession here, Dentsu,Taisei and considered as the second Moritomo scandal. So first of all, the New York City has been so much excited to hear the news of the new Biden election result. But in fact, who knows, as Steve mentioned before, he is considered as a war criminal.And so is Susan Rice. So I am suspicious, but to me, it's time to consider myself returning, going back to New York after 9/11 report. Because of my live reports, daily live reports on Ground Zero site right after 9/11 occurred, I was thrown into jail. Somebody didn't like my report, live report, and tried to shut my mouth shut. So then I was incarcerated at New York prison and the Connecticut prison, Danbury prison, for 652 days after 9/11, the term of between 2005 to 2007. Well, here I am in Tokyo, but it's for me, to me, it's time to go back to New York. And I was kind of waited until the Trump has gone. Let's see. Let me put my personal stuff aside today, and I can introduce who is Suga Yoshihiro, new Prime Minister of Japan, for 10 minutes. After this briefing, if you have any questions, I'll take a Q&A at the end of my session. He has three sons, as I said, and he comes from Akita Prefecture, and he has a strong countryside accent and a certain way to act. And he was trying to make himself as a low profile during the term of Abe administration since 2012. And for 8 years, Suga Yoshihiro has been a chief cabinet secretary who never answered the straight question from the media. Daily media briefing at cabinet office, he was very tough and deniable and not giving journalists and newspaper media the straight answers. So some people, directors, made two movies about his behavior. One is M, a journalist. It's a documentary about Isoko Mochizuki. She is a staff writer of Tokyo Shimbun newspaper, and she was expelled from the cabinet media group that because of her questions. She was just like a US journalist who kept attacking or giving a tough questions at in front of Trump. Maybe you remember some of CNN and other journalists were so treated as a meaning badly by Trump. That she's considered as that kind of a tough questioner. And Suga Yoshihiro hated her so much. So we made a movie, and I was in that movie, and I made an arrangement to that major member of the FCCJ, a foreign press club in Japan, could interview her at one of the interview room at FCCJ, foreign press club. So that scene was taped, videotaped, and was in the movie. So if you have a chance to see this movie, M, Mochizuki Isoko non-fiction movie, then you will see him live press conference in the last 8 years, and you will know his behavior, his pattern of his talk and his accent. And he is from Akita Prefecture, and their family business is strawberry farmer. But he's not poor labor class farmer. His grandfather used to be a local legislator for years. So his family is meishi, a well-known established family of that area. And now he's 71 year old, and graduated from Hosei University. And of course, he has been in the middle center of Olympic Tokyo 2020 concession group, especially Dentsu. Have you ever heard Dentsu? It's a tycoon, huge PR company that takes care of government matter as a parent company. And this Olympic Games, they have so much money, bribes spread and send to the members of International Olympic, IOC, JOC. So he is a center of this concession as a chief, a deputy minister of Internal Affairs and Communication Department during the era of Koizumi administration. He was actual top who controls the Japanese media and communication communication industry. So that's a profile about Suga Yoshihiro, a new prime minister. And I will introduce three mastermind behind of him. Who is behind of not only Abe administration, but this Suga administration, the same people. Number one is, as you know, Kazuhiro Sugita. He is a present a deputy cabinet secretary since Abe returned to the administration as the second time, year 2012. And he has been a chief police, a chief of police department, especially he controls the thought police. It means a secret police department, controls the people's thought and media and political enemies. And he is the master mind and master player of present scandal of the rejection of six members of Japan Academic Committee. And he is the actual person who controls media and those kind of thoughts. And these six members rejected by Sugita-san, Sugita secretary, cabinet secretary, all science, social scientists who has history to against, express the expressing the against criminal conspiracy law in Japan, which that was legislated June 2017, as well as pleading guilty law, new law, and same year, March 2017, these six members of scientists, social scientists, clearly rose their voices against legislating these horrible new criminal laws, pressured and pushed by the U.S. government. And of course, we know the conspiracy law and the pleading guilty law in the United States was horrible. And I was, I am one of the victims of the as a political prisoner of conspiracy. And second person of mastermind who controls this Suga Yoshihiro administration is David Atkinson. He is an Oxford graduate. He came to Japan around 1990 as a financial analyst, financial analyst. First, he's hired by Anderson Consulting. And the second, he worked for Lehman Brothers. Then third, he was a financial analyst as hired by Goldman Sachs Japan. And after resigning Goldman Sachs Japan, he became author of many advising book, nonfiction book, to give practical advice and policy to the policy makers. And he was has been invited many of advisor, senior advisors, special advisors of government institutions and administrations, including Japan National Tourist Organization. And he has a website to promote Japanese rural areas, how to raise their business and how to promote those countryside to the visitors. And he has English site as well. So if you Google David Atkinson, you will see him, who he is, who's behind of Suga Yoshihiro. When we look at his policy making, it's obvious. It's the same as what he had, David Atkinson had advised to the Japanese market through his more than 10 books. And he is a guru. And the third one, oh, by the way, I sent you three emails yesterday, this morning to Steve with attachment of this Wikipedia. It's written in Japanese, but you can press the translation button. You will know the profile of David Atkinson. And the third person, a third mastermind of Suga is Takenaka-san. Takenaka-san is present director of Persona, the private company. And he used to be a minister of internal affairs and communications during the era of Koizumi administration. So that means he was a former boss. Takenaka was a former boss of Suga Yoshihiro. Suga-san used to work for him. So then they are identical. They are like twins. Whatever Takenaka-san says, it means Suga-san a statement. When Suga-san doesn't make any statement, so we listen to what Takenaka presently stating, saying. So that means he is like a shadow of Suga Yoshihiro in private sect. So these three persons are three masterminds of Suga administration. And if you have any questions about the prime minister, I don't know everything about him, but I learned a lot. So any questions? That's all my presentation of today. And so Jay doesn't go too much specific because I am so afraid of the secret police cabinet general secretary of the cabinet, Sugita-san, is still digging and searching and listening what journalist says. And we've been so much suppressed. And during the era of Abe administration, I thought it was Suga who controls media, suppress the media so badly. And our rank of free press rank went down after 2012. Then it was caused by Suga-san. We thought at the time, so we made two movies, but in fact, it was Sugita-san, secret police boss, that controls everything. He even controls the Suga-san. Even after Abe left the administration, same person in the same way journalism has been suppressed. So this is the best I can say. Otherwise, you will see me in jail again, this time in Tokyo, in Japan. That I don't want to say that because my husband had a stroke last year. I have to take care of him. Financially, daily, I need to change his diapers every day and feed him. So I can't allow myself going back to jail again. So I have to stop what I'm talking now. Let me shut my mouth. Thank you.
And I wanted to say that, I mean, one of the things that we are very concerned about is the role of the United States and Japan. and Richard Armitage, who is former Assistant Secretary of State and is a
member of PSIS. Yes.
PSIS and also the American Enterprise Institute has been actively going to Japan and training people to tell them that nuclear energy is okay and they should not only continue to expand the nuclear operations, power plants in Japan, but also support the U.S. Japan Security Agreement and for Japan to join the United States in intervening and organizing against China. So that is the role of Richard Armitage, supporting the U.S. Military Security Agreement. And one of the things they've said to the Japanese people from the United States is that nuclear power is safe. They don't have anything to worry about, and denialism that radiation is not a danger. And our next speaker is Dr. Navin Gordon, who is a people's doctor, has been involved in supporting Native American people and other community people to defend them against corporate and government policies that have harmed them. And so welcome, Navin.
I did not have a specific presentation. I can make a few little points, but I thought maybe I would be here for questions. But I'll just make a couple of key points about the nuclear power. The first is that there was an agreement in 1959 between the International Atomic Agency, Energy Agency, and the World Health Organization, an agreement whereby the World Health Organization could not ever study radiation and its effect on human beings. Radiation and its effect of causing disease. That they would not do that unless it was mutually agreed upon. And of course, the International Atomic Energy Agency has never agreed to any studies regarding atomic energy and health. So that's the underlying problem we have, is that there is very little information. Number two, there has been never been established any lower threshold for radiation doses in human beings. There's never been established by any public health agency. Those two things are key. There was actual suppression of studies regarding nuclear accidents, particularly Hiroshima and Nagasaki was suppressed for years. And the same thing was done after Chernobyl, actual suppression of the medical institutions. They were not allowed to do any studies. So I just wanted to say that, and also that these nucleotides remain in the environment for very long periods of time. The two that are most important for this particular situation are tritium, which has a half-life of some 7 years and combines with water, becomes water. And the other is what is the other active ingredient there that's the most concerned, has an active half-life of 30 years. And so the final thing is that the studies being done to say that the area is clean by the Japanese government apparently just gamma detectors. Gamma detectors do not detect beta radiation, and that is what's been given off by the two most high contaminants of the area. The basic problem we face with nuclear power and nuclear energy. So if there are any specific questions, it might be better for me to just answer those.
Hi, Nathan. It's me, Sarah.
Hello, sir.
I'd like to know, there's WHO tried to hide the facts and disturb all scholars' research about the dangerous of contaminated radiation, not only Hiroshima, Nagasaki, but Chernobyl. Then yes. How do you academic scholars try to get the right specific information about the contamination? How do you get the information, may I ask you?
Well, there have been some independent researchers who've done studies and published them. One book that's a very powerful study, if you want to get it, is called Chernobyl: Consequences of the Catastrophe for the People and the Environment. That was published by the New York Academy of Science, I believe.
Okay.
And that is, but otherwise you're right. It has to be done by independent organizations, independent scientists, because otherwise the World Health Organization will not do the studies, and the studies are suppressed. As a matter of fact, the other thing that's happening is that some of these organizations are actually promoting the fact that lower level radiation could actually be good for people. Therefore, they should loosen up the regulations on nuclear energy.
Like IAEA.
Yes. And you know, so it's a tragic situation that we face. Mm.
Okay, thank you so much.
So our next speaker is Eric Sheehan with No Olympics LA. Eric?
So yeah, my name's Eric. I'm with No Olympics LA, originally from the Bay Area though. So we don't think the Olympics can be reformed. We want them canceled. Not just this year, not just in Tokyo or LA, but everywhere. The Olympics have always been like a pretty unpopular thing in the cities that host it, but a lot of that opposition has historically been focused on budgets, taxes, and like finance. So in our first 3 years, No Olympics LA's analysis has explicitly rejected this framework in favor of a people-centered framework. So we like to ask who wins and who loses, and we advocate for the rights for people's right to live and stay in their cities. So first I wanna talk a little bit about the example of Los Angeles 1984, a supposedly profitable games. The architect of that games, Peter Ueberroth, initiated the current full throttle corporate capitalist Olympics and described the Olympics as the perfect vehicle to join the public and private sectors in partnership, an opportunity for private enterprise to enhance itself and show what is good about mankind. So an opportunity for private enterprise to enhance itself. The 84 games did finish with a $232 million profit. Now only $93 million of that actually stayed in the city, and it went to the LA 84 Foundation, which was a private charity, a nonprofit organization with no public control or oversight of any kind. Now in 2016, that same group, the LA 84 Foundation, had $22 million invested in Blackstone Group. Blackstone Group is the largest landlord in the world. One of their business tactics and models is buying up homes and rental properties in large concentrations in places like South LA and driving up those prices. Now, this supposed charity is literally profiting from the continued financialization of rental housing that's making cities unaffordable to their long-term residents all around the world. You know, every country that visited Tokyo with us last year was describing this as an issue that they were fighting. So when we talk about the rare financially successful Olympics, residents can't expect to benefit from that success. They'll likely actually be harmed by it when housing prices increase and their community is threatened or displaced or banished from where it once was. So the Olympics are first and foremost a grift. Residents don't ask for it. A handful of local and international wealthy power brokers put together a bid without the help or consent of the people living there. So PR firms are deployed to sell the city to the IOC. Politicians latch on to an easy popularity boost, and development companies buy for lucrative contracts. Now the end result is almost always those with power enhancing themselves and they're cementing their economic and political footholds. So these boosters come from the same groups every time around. We've got politicians, developers, and the security sector. Those are three big ones that we've identified. We spoke with Raquel Rolnick, who was the UN Special Rapporteur on the right to adequate housing from 2008 to 2014. And she described mega events as things that mobilize people's emotions to do things in cities that you could never do without enthusiastic public support. She called them a marketing device that offer cities as a place for financial capital to park. So when a bid is confirmed, there's a race for these development rights, and a state of exception is ushered in, wherein corporations race to secure these contracts that would never be approved if not for the pressing needs of the coming Olympics. So governments will often sell public land at massive discounts, as with Tokyo 2020's Olympic Village. They'll approve development of lands previously protected, as with the sacred Mount Gariwang in Pyeongchang. They approve rush and expensive infrastructure projects that don't serve working class residents, as with Los Angeles's 28 by 28 initiative, which was already over budget before COVID happened. They also destroy and displace and banish entire communities to build parking lots, as in Rio in 2016. So the games feed on people's emotions, on their nationalism and pride, in order to get political support for developments that will make massive profits while doing harm to people. Now, throughout 2019 and early 2020, Los Angeles Mayor Eric Garcetti became fond of telling crowds, "I sell LA for a living, and it's my job to sell LA." So that's what he's doing. He's literally marketing the city to these developers. Now, Garcetti and others in LA government called LA 28 a no-build Olympics because we already have stadiums and all that kind of stuff. But that no-build Olympics happened to coincide with what they deemed a hotel shortage crisis, wherein LA needed thousands of hotel rooms to be built to accommodate for the games and other upcoming events. Now, in the last 15 years alone, officials in LA handed out $1 billion worth of incentives to hotel developers in downtown LA alone, yet they're still demanding we build more today. Our mayor actually owns a hotel, by the way. Now, at least two former city council members have been indicted for development-related corruption charges in the last year. And if that sounds related, it is. These areas close to venues see prices driven up by speculation invited by these leaders. Entire city blocks are destroyed, as with the FIG, now known as Exposition Point, right across from Exposition Park, where the 84 games were held. Tenants are evicted to make way for tourists. And people experiencing homelessness are banished and forcibly relocated by police to make the tourists feel safe and present the image of a clean city, which connects pretty directly to Baron de Coubertin, the creator of the modern day Olympics, eugenicist standpoint. Now, policing is also a big focus for an Olympics LA, the business of policing. So, you know, LA 28, like LA 84 before it, will bring an increased police and state violence to a city already plagued with the most murderous police force in the nation. LAPD kills, by and large, the highest number of people every year. So LAPD themselves have told us, in order to host the Olympic Games, they're gonna need 3,000 new police officers, a 30% increase, just to hold the Olympic Games safely. So one big legacy of 84 was that increased militarized policing. LAPD used weapons, tanks, and tactics during and in the aftermath of the games that undoubtedly contributed to the 92 uprising in Los Angeles. Now, LA 28 plans to use facial recognition technology in place of physical tickets for attendees, just as Tokyo planned for 2020. The business of policing is a big deal here. One thing that NOlympics has recognized is that in our transnational efforts, is that policing is a big part of Olympic resistance. And another big part of Olympic resistance from all the groups that we've met and worked with is from groups that were formed to fight displacement and defend tenants. And this is no coincidence that all of the groups that gathered together in Tokyo about a year ago were focused on housing and land use. That's at the center of everything. Whether we're looking at Kasumigoga residents who were displaced for both the 64 and then the 2020 games to make way for the Tokyo National Stadium, or Rio residents in Villa Autodromo who were fighting displacement in 2016 and were removed to make way for our comrades in Hangar no Kai, our allies in Tokyo, they centered their fight on the rights of the unhoused. And Olympics LA was formed from the Democratic Socialists of America Los Angeles Housing and Homelessness Committee. So the struggle against these games is always centered on land use and housing. When Olympics LA visited Tokyo in 2019, We were invited by Hangrai Nokai and Okotoa Link for this first ever transnational anti-Olympic summit. Six, seven countries were represented. And during that visit, I visited Fukushima with that delegation to see the effects firsthand. And what I learned was shocking, but not terribly surprising. The handling of Fukushima follows the pattern Olympic Games have been setting for years. So while the government pretended to have this crisis under control, it planned to host the Games as cover for its dereliction of duty to residents whose entire lives were destroyed, displaced, and ignored. The business of greenwashing Fukushima recovery and reconstruction is more important to local and federal politicians than affecting actual recovery. Now, government support is running out for thousands of displaced residents while the crisis continues to destroy the ecosystem. Instead of funneling money towards those affected by this nuclear crisis, they're funneling money to a PR event, a torch run, a baseball game 90 kilometers away, all facades to promote this recovery reconstruction narrative. Now, it's better to be remembered for an Olympics than your failure to respond to a devastating triple disaster. So, we see the incentives of the politicians there. I met Ihara-san, who spoke earlier, on this trip to Fukushima when we visited what I could only describe as an apology museum run by TEPCO, the company responsible for the nuclear reactors that exploded. And there we viewed this spectacular triple projection movie documenting the disaster. Inside, we watched this just terrible film that Ihara-san told me to film and record and share with the world. And just outside, as she showed us, there are piles of contaminated earth that line the roads to and from the site, miles and miles around. So this focus on image over outcomes for residents is the Olympic way. Ignoring and even capitalizing on crises facing residents for the sake of improvement, recovery, modernization, and often very openly development is the Olympic way. So no matter where they're held, this way persists and entrenches power while insulating bad actors from oversight and accountability. 2 days after traveling to Fukushima, I was back in Tokyo with No Olympics LA and Hangrai Nokai. And Hangrai Nokai had set up this exhibit with some other folks full of images and documents from Japan's Olympic history. I saw a lot of images of Kasumi Yoka and the previous area that they'd been evicted from for the 64 games. But one thing popped out to me, and that was a pamphlet about the Nagano 98 games. And two of our comrades read through it, and what it explained was that three people stood to benefit from the games: the mayor, the governor of Nagano, and the largest developer. And that's a pattern that we see here in Los Angeles, that we see in Tokyo 2020, and we see all over the world. The Olympics is and always has been a tool for local and national politicians to entrench their place in power. Business is the point of the Olympics, and you cannot separate the aims of those businesses from the IOC and the Olympic Games.
Okay, thank you, Eric, very much for that report. And our last speaker is also a world expert on the Olympics and the class nature of the Olympics and in sports in general, and is written a document on the Olympics, which was going to come out prior to the COVID crisis, but I think we're still going to try to work to get it out. Dr.
Charles.
George Wright, Dr. George Wright, is a former professor at Chico State University, retired, and also Skyline College, and has been involved in looking at the history of corruption, the history of Olympics, the nature of the Olympics. And when you look today, it's almost unheard of. The idea, the very idea of having an Olympics in the middle of a world pandemic is almost inconceivable. Yet that is what the Japanese government is doing, Japanese capitalists are doing, with the support of the United States. So I think that the title of this session is The Madness from Fukushima to the Olympics. And I would say that continuing the effort to have the Olympics in the midst of a world pandemic is an example of the criminal insanity of the Japanese government. So welcome, George.
First of all, I'd like to associate my comments with Eric's presentation. I'm of solidarity with your effort. In fact, I grew up in Los Angeles and was a track star at Los Angeles Washington High School back in the 1960s. So I know the area very well. Just a little bit of background. I've written a number of articles and a book on the politics of sport over the last 25 or 30 years. And I've also attended five Olympic Games as a spectator. And obviously while there, I was an observer to what was going on, as well as I've attended almost every World Track and Field Championship that's been held since 1983, including the 1991 World Track and Field Championships that were held in Tokyo. And I spent two glorious weeks in Tokyo back in 1991, and I have wonderful memories about that experience, particularly the food, okay? What I'd like to comment, one of the problems of being further down the list of panelists is people have already covered what you plan to talk about. So I'd like to kind of narrow it down to just a few points. One, I'd like to make some comments about what the Olympic movement is, or what the Olympic Games is. Secondly, I'd like to talk about why Tokyo was selected to host the 2020 Olympic Games. And then thirdly, I'd like to make some general comments about the impact of COVID-19 on the Tokyo 2020 Games and obviously the rescheduling of that competition for next year. The first point about what the Olympic Games are, one, it was referred earlier, it is a mega sporting event. I would also want to add that it's the International Olympic Committee is an international non-government organization that operates basically as a non-state actor, as a nation or nation-state itself. It was formed back in the 1890s by Baron Pierre de Coubertin within the context of inter-imperial rivalry and competition at the time. And de Coubertin's philosophy was to, one, prepare French youth for in the area of physical education to compete on the playing fields as well in the trenches with imperial rivalries, but also his philosophy was aimed at bringing the youth of the world together in quote-unquote brotherhood. The games have been scheduled every 4 years since 1896. One of the keynotes of the organizers of the games from its inception is that the Olympics transcends politics. And again, its commitment is peace and brotherhood. The obvious point, and this has been brought out by presentations already this evening, is that the Olympics are highly political. And in fact, there's absolutely no distinction between politics and economics and international sport. The next point I want to make about the International Olympic Movement is an interesting point that I think helps to explain the current situation related to the Tokyo 20 Games. And that is that the original economic orientation of the International Olympic Committee was that it was a nonprofit organization. The elites, Western elites, industrialists, sports people, aristocrats, etc., that were members of the International Olympic Committee basically funded their lifestyle out of their own pockets. In fact, Avery Brundage, who was the president of the International Olympic Committee, a U.S. citizen from 1952 till about 1972, excuse me, he actually funded the IOC's activities out of his own back pocket. Who paid for the games were the cities themselves who were selected to host those games. Building stadiums, infrastructure, as Eric commented, security and all these kinds of issues. But in the 1980s, the Olympic movement was transformed from a nonprofit structure or organization to a for-profit organization. Perhaps the person that's most important in this process was Juan Antonio Samaranch, who a Spaniard who was the president of the IOC from 1980 to I think 1996, if my memory is correct. This transformation to a for-profit structure was within the context of the economic transformation of the global economy. Some call that globalization. And certainly neoliberalism played a dramatic role in this related to privatization, et cetera. Eric makes reference to Peter Uberoff, who really is the one that kind of framed or first set up the template for a privatized Olympic Games when the Los Angeles Games were organized and put on back in 1984. Obviously, I attended those games as well. How does that privatized for-profit system work? Basically, the IOC sells the brand, the International Olympic brand, to global international sponsors to use those symbols and icons for their advertising. And secondly, the IOC sells broadcast rights, television rights, to a specific international telecommunications conglomerates. The largest source of revenue for the IOC in this process is from NBC Universal. And they provide a significant amount of revenue for the IOC. Just to give you some idea of this process, as early as 1972, the International Olympic Committee was dead broke. The money that they had was out of the pocket of Brundage, as I mentioned earlier. Garnering broadcast rights as well as sponsorships, in the 2001-2004 Olympiad, which included the Athens Olympic Games in 2004, the International Olympic Committee was able to garner some $2.9 billion. In the Rio Olympiad 2016, some $5.16 billion had been garnered by the IOC. And for the Tokyo 20 Olympics, which have been postponed, obviously, the IOC was able to garner some $5.7 billion. Now, so hosting the games is incredibly profitable for the International Olympic Committee, for the forces that Eric refers to as well, construction companies, hotel magnates, and the like in the host city, as well as extremely profitable for the corporations who use the iconic symbols of the Olympic movement, as well as the NBC networks and other international telecommunications interests as well. That's, by the way, one of the reasons why there are as many commercials while we're watching the Olympic Games on television. They have to raise money somehow to pay the IOC for this privilege, quote unquote. Now, this is going to be relevant when we refer to the current situation related to Tokyo 20 and COVID-19. The second area I'd like to comment on is why was Tokyo selected in 2013 by the IOC to host the 2020 Olympic Games? just a point of information, the process to gain an Olympic Games generally now is about 9 years, 2 years for the various cities organizing themselves to present a presentation, to give presentations to the IOC. Then the IOC going through a selection process, narrowing the number of cities down to just a handful, and then selecting one city 7 years prior to the year that the games were to be held, or are scheduled to be held. So the selection for Tokyo 2020 took place in 2013. Are we okay time-wise?
Yes, we're okay.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So why did the IOC select Tokyo in 2013 to host the 2020 Games? Keeping in mind that Fukushima had happened 2.5 years earlier. So we know very clearly that the IOC was aware of the dangers that Fukushima wrought, not only in the area, but also throughout the country and certainly in Tokyo as well. So they were not blind to the nuclear crisis that Japan faced at the time. On the 7th of September 2013, there were three cities that were narrowed down to the selection process. One was Istanbul, the other was Madrid, and thirdly was Tokyo. That particular afternoon, the three cities organizing committees gave presentations to the IOC, and the one we'd like to focus on is the Tokyo 20 presentation. In fact, Abe, who had been in Buenos Aires, as it was mentioned earlier tonight, flew directly to Tokyo to be involved in the presentation. And when he gave his speech to the IOC, he said the following: Mr. President and distinct members of the International Olympic Committee, it would be a tremendous honor for us to host the Games in 2020 in Tokyo. Now, in reference to Fukushima, he goes on to say, quote, one of the safest cities in the world now and in 2020. Some may have concerns about Fukushima. Let me assure you, the situation is under control. This famous quote that he gave, let me assure you, the situation is under control. It has never done and never do any damage to Tokyo. It is never done and never do any damage to Tokyo. Now, even more specifically, once Abe had given his presentation, a IOC member from Norway by the name of Gerhard Heiberg asked Abe a specific question about Fukushima. This is Heiberg's question, quote, Prime Minister, excuse me for taking it up, but the question about Fukushima, we have heard a lot and almost every day from media how bad this is. Of course, we believe you when you say it will have no effect on Tokyo. Could you tell us how you can say that and also why it is like that? So we get the assurance. Also, technically, from your side, please. Abe's response was as follows, and I'm going to give you a portion of what he said. Quote, I will give you my conclusion first. It, that is Fukushima, poses no problem whatsoever. I ask that you read through the headlines and instead appraise the true situation. The impact of the contaminated water have been isolated to an area of 0.3 tenths of a square kilometer within the harbor that fronts Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power station, and it is completely blocked. And then he goes on to say, we've been monitoring the situation, et cetera, et cetera. And then he follows up by saying, if there's any problem with Tokyo 20, I take full responsibility. So it's very clear that Abe lied when he made that presentation to the IOC. Now, again, the IOC had three cities three cities that they were considering. So the fundamental question is, why was then Tokyo given the 2020 Olympics? I've written, there are a number of reasons why the IOC made that decision. First, Istanbul and Madrid's bids were considered too problematic owing to issues involved. Turkish journalist Sezik Şendar explains, quote, "For the IOC, environmental concerns in Japan appeared less urgent than the Syrian war on Turkey's border, a harsh crackdown against anti-government protesters recently in Istanbul, and Spain's recession and high unemployment." There are a number of other reasons as well, but finally, I would argue that the key reason was Abe's reassurance to the IOC that Fukushima was, quote, under control, and that Tokyo was safe from radioactive contamination. Sports journalist David Bond elaborates that Abe's answer, quote, settled any last-minute nerves on the part of the IOC, unquote. While IOC member Sir Craig Reedy, who had chaired the working group which oversaw the evaluation of the three cities, declared, quote, "The prime minister, that is Abe, dealt with the one big issue. And so there was no problem for the IOC to make this decision." We know, and has been reported tonight on this panel, the problems still persist. The next thing I want to say is the current situation related to the Tokyo Olympics and COVID. I think all of us understand COVID and the great implications, the variety of economic, social, psychological, biological implications. In March of 2020, the IOC and the Tokyo Olympic Organizing Committee had a series of discussions dealing with the issue. And in March, it was announced that the Olympics for 2020 were going to be postponed for 1 year to 2021. Thomas Bach, who is the current president of the International Olympic Committee, he's a Swiss citizen, said that the Olympics being postponed will help to celebrate an end of COVID, and it will serve as a light at the end of the tunnel. He goes on to say, quote, "The fragile post-corona world needs the unifying power of the Olympic Games, and Olympic Games will be in 2020. Now, I'd just like to make one general point that I think is very central to this story. There are many others that we can comment on. Why is there still discussions about the Olympic Games being held next summer in Tokyo? As Steve just proposed, the madness of even suggesting that an Olympic Games will be held within the context of a pandemic. I think it's pretty straightforward if we wade through the economics of all of this. It's about money. And we're already seeing that transpire in the United States and in Europe and other countries related to sport itself, because these federations, these leagues, these conferences, whether they're professional or college, are businesses and they survive on income. And the basic source of income is twofold in general. One is television revenue, and secondly is ticket sales. Obviously, when you cannot have spectators in the stands, you lose a lot of money. And what we've seen is in the NBA, the NFL in the United States, Major League Baseball in the United States, we see in Europe, we see the various domestic football leagues, or soccer as some call them. We've seen the UEFA Champions League, the UEFA European League, Europa League, et cetera, continue to have competitions within the context of the pandemic, dealing with, and also in the United States, we see collegiate football being played. In fact, today, the Pac-12 resumed its 2020 season this year, because these entities cannot survive without revenue. And so they're putting the lives of these athletes in jeopardy. And certainly the athletes themselves have to make some very tough decisions. Most of them have decided to operate within the stated protocols that are being presented by the various leagues, conferences, and federations. But some aren't. For example, related to Major League Baseball in San Francisco, Buster Posey, who's a catcher for the Giants, he refused to play baseball because of the health risks related to his family. I personally, and I think the consensus of the panel, is that there will not be an Olympic Games in Tokyo next year. But I assure you that the entities involved, the IOC, the Tokyo 20 Olympic Committee, and the major networks, are still trying to figure out some way to have some kind of competition next year, to just so that there will be the broadcasts of whatever they propose, so that the money or the revenue can be generated. If it can't, that entities like the International Olympic Committee will be in dire straits economically if not this year or next year, down the line. So I think that's all I really want to say at this point. I hope it opens up for some questions.
Thank you, George, and for that report. And I think we have a clear understanding of why they're going to proceed with the Olympics at this point, regardless of this worldwide pandemic and the threat to the athletes and the people of Japan and the world as a result of transmission. I wanted to, before we open up the discussion, let everyone know that No Nukes Action is planning to have work towards an International Day of Action on March the 11th, the 10th anniversary of the Fukushima, and to tie it into a campaign against the Olympics being held in Japan, if they have not canceled it by March. But knowing who is in charge of the Japanese government, they plan to be headlong, move along, and regardless of the reality of the situation. So,
Steve, could I interject just a point or two? One, the Olympics, as I stated earlier, have been canceled three times. And one was during the World War I, 1916. That was scheduled to be held in Berlin. The 1940 Olympics were canceled, and Tokyo was scheduled to host those, but the Japanese government pulled out of hosting those games in 1938. They had other priorities at the time. And the 1944 games were canceled as well. London was scheduled to host those games. This will be the first time that the Olympic Games have ever been postponed. And the leadership of the IOC has stated clearly, if there is a need to reschedule the games next year, they will not be rescheduled. The Tokyo Games will not occur. What's going to be interesting is that the Winter Olympics are scheduled to be held in Beijing, the winter, February of 2022. And so that will be the next discussion we'll have about politics and the Olympic movement. That's all I have to say.
Okay. Tsukuru, would you want to add anything?
No, not to that. I think we can, I think we should give audience, chance to ask questions that they have.
Thank you. Thank you for your presentation and your specific information about regarding Olympics. Thank you, Dr. George. And I have one question for you and possibly Nathan and Eric, if you can give me your answer or your opinion about the Tokyo Olympic 2020. I believe it is obvious that European or American delegation wouldn't be able to make it next summer due to COVID-19 lockdowns and pandemic is still going on and getting worse and worse, it's fact. In fact, those athletes cannot have any practice and preparation until then, they're not ready. So then, without those participation of athletes from foreign country, from other countries, how can they organize the actual Olympic game next year, despite the fact that Dr. George just mentioned that major network need to make some profit, so they may have some type of Olympic game next year, but in fact there will be no athlete most likely. Then how do they make it possible? You have any idea?
Well, as I've said, I personally don't think there will be any competition at all for the reasons that you state. I mean, Japan is not even allowing foreign visitors into the country at this point. Although, right. Interestingly, this weekend, there's supposed to be some major international competition with athletes from Korea and Russia and several other places as an experiment related to how to deal with COVID protocols and the like. Including China as well. But you hit the nail on the head, because the Olympics would include some 11,000 athletes from some 206 countries. Athletes have to schedule their training over a long period of time. Each individual nation has trials for the Olympics in various sports, et cetera. So we're talking about a global process and network of preparations and tryouts for the games. And each country is dealing with COVID and the acceleration of COVID, and it's in at the same time. So realistically, it's going to be impossible to have that kind of competition. At the same time, I haven't ruled out in my mind that something might occur on a much, much smaller scale, and it might be symbolic. But the bottom line is that these entities are going to lose a lot of money, meaning that the IOC will probably have to find a way to refund money to NBC. The corporate sponsors will probably ask for refunds, et cetera. So we're really talking about the destabilization of the IOC as a functioning entity and the possibility of it collapsing if this is over a prolonged period of time, which it probably will, meaning COVID. So why I just have a little bit of reservations, because I didn't believe that the NFL was going to be able to pull off a football season this year myself. And so far, they've been somewhat successful in carrying out a football season. So Who knows? But I think realistically, there will not be a games next year. Mm-hmm. I hope somebody else has some better insight than I do.
Thank you so much.
You know, I love the thought of this being the games that shuts down the IOC forever, certainly. I can't say I'm that hopeful that it'll go that way. You know, the one thing that happens with the Olympics, wherever it goes, is what I mentioned in my remarks, a state of exception. And, you know, that state of exception was necessary for the NFL to be able to do what they did. And I wouldn't put it past the IOC to try some sort of mega quarantine where, you know, a large amount of funding goes to, you know, paying people to hole up in apartments, both in their home countries during, you know, initial tests.
Right. That's what the NBA did, that bubble situation as well.
Right. Yeah. And trying to make it happen in some way, shape, or form. Now I don't think it's going to go down that way, and I do think it's going to be canceled, and I'm hopeful that it will be canceled. But the longer that the IOC waits, the more harm that will be done. The harm that happens from an Olympic Games doesn't happen during the 2 weeks of the games. It happens in the run up to it.
Right.
And so with, you know, long, you know, 7 years before, you know, between getting the bid and starting the games, there's a lot of harm that's been done in Fukushima and elsewhere. And it's only going to continue under this pandemic.
Right, exactly. I agree.
Thank you, Eric.
By the way, I do want to add, I'm a big time sports fan, okay? And I walk a tightrope between being a critic of capitalism and globalization, but loving the competitions, okay? What I like to refer to in 1936, parallel with the Berlin Olympic Games, Hitler's, or the Nazi Games, as many people understand it to be, that's where Jesse Owens showed, challenged the Aryan supremacy ideas of Jesse Owens, a lot of reality and myth in that. Simultaneously in Barcelona, the Communist Party and I think it was called the Red Sport International, which was a Communist Party organized the people's games or the popular games. And in an ideal sense, I still want to see sport and I still want to see competition. And the idea would be to have a people's Olympics, if that makes any sense. But we're a long way from that at that point. We need a socialist world to be able to pull that off.
Yeah, I mean, there were a number of workers' Olympiads held in the early years, 28, 32. I believe it was around 32, the workers' Olympiad actually had more athletes and more attendees than
the Olympics.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Are there any other comments or questions? I think this is the first international forum tying together Fukushima and the Olympics. So I think we can see a connection in both of them. What is causing the crisis to both is capitalism, the crisis of capitalism, and basically the bankruptcy, financial and political bankruptcy of capitalism, both in Fukushima with the disaster and the denialism that radiation is a danger, in the Olympics saying that they should not only ignore the nuclear disaster in Fukushima, that it's been overcome, but also they should ignore the pandemic. Sure. So on all counts, it's an example thing, I think, of the craziness and the madness of the system, really, that at this point, those two things combined. And I think in the United States, the need to take this up in the Los Angeles, to oppose the Los Angeles Olympics, maybe even having an international forum about the cost of the Olympics to people, the homeless, to the issue of housing, speculation against gentrification, racism, ethnic cleansing. I know in Tokyo, working class people had their homes razed for this Olympics. They were thrown out of their homes. I think it's obviously an international issue, the protection of people against the marauders, basically these titans who want to use the Olympics to gouge the public and to carry on their profit ventures, really. That's what these are about.
Steve, one of the interesting things about COVID and sport is that Nike, which is this multi-billion dollar conglomerate that controls much of sport, and it certainly controls track and field, international track and field, and it plays a major role in the IOC as well. I just read a couple weeks ago that owing to COVID, Nike has lost almost $1 billion in sales. And some of my track and field buddies who are critical of Nike's control of sport, we all celebrated that, meaning maybe Nike will stop sponsoring track and field on an international level and we'll have some good stuff now, you know. So there are some silver linings in all of this as well, pointing out all the great, great contradictions of capitalism.
Sukuru?
Yeah, earlier I said, like, I have nothing to say, but I just wanted to, before we end, you know, because of the wind and everything, Aihara-san's speech was unfortunately not very audible. So I just wanted to, like, point out several things so that you guys didn't miss it. So, you know, earlier, so several points that Ms. Aihara made are very reflective of what Eric so eloquently described as the style of the Olympics. So the torch relay that she was describing, so it's not really a relay. So, you know, when we imagine Olympics, you know, relay or regular relay really is like one runner goes to like runs to the runner and passes on the baton, right? It's not like that. In Fukushima, what's planned is it's not a consecutive relay. A runner is taken, driven from one runway to another. Because what they're trying to do in Fukushima is they're trying to show, they're trying to showcase what the image that the Japanese government wants to show to the world as the restoration of Fukushima. So, you know, what she was telling me when we were planning this was that when you go there, actually the planned, you know, relay locations, what you see is like really cleaned up street, you know, maybe like 100 meters or 200 meters. But that's the only thing that's there. You know, everything else is ruins, actually, all around it. The Japanese government is just creating this, what should I say, this kind of location, scene, you know, if you will, kind of like a film, you know, film set, really, so that to show to the world that, you know, the Fukushima is restored. So that's one thing, and another thing, and I will end. So the earlier in Ms. Aihara's speech, what she was saying, you know, she was asking a question, you know, we have to pay attention to what's being preserved and what's being destroyed. So what's being destroyed in Fukushima is something that we want the world to see. So they're cleaning up, they're destroying the ruins, right? I mean, the buildings that are collapsed and stuff like that. So, so, you know, it's on the surface, it can be seen, it's a good thing that they are spending money to clean up the city, but people are not returning there. So they're just creating a scene to the, for the benefit of the government and the benefit of the power plant, the Toden power plant company. So these are the two points that I wanted to make. Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, well, are
Hi, Blair Beekman here. Can I make a...
Yes.
Thank you. If I can make a few quick points. I wanted to mention nuclear questions a bit and just ask yourselves, maybe just a thought to close the meeting. There's a Russian treaty, a nuclear treaty proposal work that they've been working with, I think, Iran and the Middle East the past few years. It's really interesting work. Check it out. Ask how it compares to if Biden becomes president, he's going to want to bring back the Iran treaty work. How do the two compare? It should be interesting. And really in the local area, community energy, like East Bay Community Energy, they're really questioning their future of nuclear power use. And the fact that, you know, they're basically financed by nuclear power at this point. How do we start to take the steps at this time to ask them to stop? I don't know what exactly that is, but I thought I would put that out here. This seems the appropriate place to do that. They have meetings every month, about four or five meetings, public meetings a month. I try to go to them, and yourselves, if you can, try to attend and start to ask them, you know, what steps can we take to leave nuclear energy? I mean, what they don't use in nuclear energy at the local level, they finance themselves with it. And how do we step away from all of that? That's important to myself. And of course, I do the work with accountable technology practices. Maybe that can help the work in LA. And I mention it in the chat, and I'm always working on it. And I'm real hopeful about it. And that's about it. Thanks.
One of the issues is, of course, the decommissioning of the nuclear plants. There are over 100 nuclear plants in the United States. And there's a struggle over the cast that they're putting them in, thin-walled casts. They're not properly protected. And of course, as usual, the capitalists are not interested in paying for the decommissioning of the nuclear plants. And as long as all those wasted nuclear rods or used nuclear rods are basically stored at the nuclear plants. They're a dangerous hazard in an earthquake or flood or other climate catastrophe. So we're facing a situation in the United States with these massive number of nuclear plants of Fukushima, another Chernobyl. And of course, the media and the proponents of nuclear power are denying that. In fact, they want to spend more money, including Biden, both the Republicans and Democrats are united about continuing to use nuclear power. Small nuclear plants is their latest plan to have nuclear packages. Small nuclear packages wouldn't have the problem of big nuclear packages, you know. So where you put the nuclear waste, they're not really talking about that, but that's their, it's an industry, it's a business. And I think that that really is the problem of the development of energy. And unfortunately in China as well, there's an expansion of nuclear power and nuclear plants in China as well. So this is an international issue. Last comment, Sarah, were you gonna say something?
Hi, yeah, quick question. How many nuclear power plants in operation in the United States so far, do you know?
How many are what?
Nuclear power plants in operation presently in the state.
I think that there are over 80 nuclear plants. I mean, there are a large number of nuclear plants in the United States. Some have closed. In California, we've been successful in closing San Onofre and Diablo Canyon is supposed to close. But, you know, again, this was after a long battle. What is happening now on a global level and in Japan is that they're allowing them to be recommissioned, their life extension to go on for another 20, 30 years. And they're saying that they're okay. They've solved the problem of, the weakening of the pipes and the other things that happen in the course of the use of a nuclear plant. So,
okay.
Yeah, so there's still a lot of nuclear plants in operation. And recently the floods in the United States, the environmental situation or the climate situation with floods and droughts are creating further problems for safety at these plants. And that is gonna grow actually. The climate change is gonna threaten the operation of the nuclear plants and could potentially lead to a nuclear catastrophe at these plants.
By the way, there are 95 nuclear power reactors in the United States, 95.
Okay, thank you.
Corey,
Japan so far, only one nuclear reactor is in operation, Genkai in Kyushu, north part of Kyushu Island. Mm-hmm. The rest of the 53 power plants have been shut down.
I see.
Yeah.
Sirianne Roberts, did you have a comment?
Sure, yeah, hi. And also with the Olympics, this is a question for Sarah. Actually, two questions, I think.
Okay.
First off, thanks for sharing your story. It's super great to hear that there are journalists like you.
Thank you.
And so first, I guess, I wonder if you can speak a little bit about what is the narrative around Fukushima in Tokyo right now? Especially, we've been hearing a little bit about the plans to release the contaminated water into the ocean. And I'm wondering how visible those stories are in Tokyo. Okay. And then second, so we've heard that there's some alternative media in Japan reporting a story that the IOC has actually already told the Japanese Olympics Committee that it's not gonna happen. And it's hard to tell from the United States whether that story has substance or not. So I was just wondering if that's something that you've heard of, if you have any idea whether there's any truth to that or whether it might just be a rumor.
There are no way to verify the rumor, but I've heard it too, as well. So then IOC has told unofficially that they're not gonna have the Olympics game that we expected originally, but they don't release the fact. There's no press release. There's no press conference, so they may try to hide the fact until the last minute, and it will be big surprise. It's possible. We may hear the big surprise, like until June or July, we may hear with good reason they fabricated. Then first question, we know they're still contaminated water from the river, Edogawa River, Tonegawa River, from the mountain to the Tokyo Bay. And it's still dangerous to drink water, but that's why buying water, spring water, bottled water, mineral water are very popular. Now we buy waters. Now Tokyo's sewage used to be safe, so we drink tap water. We used to drink tap water, but now people are very careful and cautious about the river from river water, because so much radiation spread all over Japan when Fukushima happened March 11th, and whole woods and forest has been contaminated by now. So then those water went down to the river, but takes years and years, sometimes 25 to 40 years, like Mount Fuji. So even pure water from Mount Fuji, Wakimizu water, may come out from the mineral water, maybe come out after like 20 to 40 years from now. So then we all know, but nothing written, because major media knew, has known, but that's never released those dangerous facts. Because if they release the disclose the fact, there will be no population in Tokyo area. The capital city will be gone. So immigrant from Tokyo to countryside are still popular. And this year they recorded the first decrease of the population of capital city Tokyo. Now we have decreasing population. So that's the fact we know. So I'm still careful about drinking water. I buy water from the southern part of Kyushu, and it's very expensive. And I stop having any fish or shellfish from Tokyo Bay, the harvest from Tokyo Bay. And I try to buy those fish and other food. Well, almost vegetarian. Now I'm almost a vegetarian, because the ocean water is so contaminated, not only the radiation, but microplastic, so dangerous. So that's the reality in happening in Tokyo.
Okay, well, I want to thank you, Sarah, and thank you for that question.
Sarah, issue of Olympic, that I understand that the Japan Olympic Committee, I think it's a Japan Olympic Committee, has or is going to be funding the ticket which has sold for this year's Olympic.
Yeah. No refund at all.
No refund?
No, they announced already there will be no refund.
Oh, I thought that they are going to return the ticket and refund it.
No, I've read that they will refund tickets that Japanese citizens or residents possess.
Yeah.
They're not gonna refund tickets that were sold outside of the United States, because auxiliary agencies are the ones that are handling those tickets. That's what I've heard.
So the Japanese Olympic Committee sold the tickets, they sold would be refunded, which means, okay, there's no money for the ticket sales comes in or gonna be, refunded. So no money there. As George said, the Olympic is for the money. And also the NBC, they might refund some of the money to refund to NBC. Now, which means that for them, there isn't gonna be any reason that they have to make it happen, the Olympic this coming year, because no money, not much of the money there, except the expenses is still there. And my gut feeling, when they announced that they're gonna refund the money, means, and since no vaccine isn't going to be ready until earliest would be the next summer. Okay, next summer doesn't mean everybody's going to get it by next summer, which means no vaccine, no money, there's no reason Olympic going to be happen, my opinion. And I think a government is sort of indicating, not they don't want to say now, but indicating that what their plan is, not make it happen, but gradually start doing it. And by, you know, early summer or late spring, they say, oh, because of this and that, well, no way we can do it. That's my opinion. And also, one more point on this new Prime Minister Suga. I have seen some of the clips of Suga answering this reporter, Isaac Mochizuki's question. And looking at it, he is like a snake. Each time when I see it, he is like a snake. And, you know, but anyway, when he became a prime minister, reporter asked, what's your policy, key policy? He said in Japanese words, jijo, kyojo, kojo, which means jijo is you help yourself first. Then you're going to help yourself. Then kyojo is ask your neighbors or families. They should help. And the last one is kojo. Kojo is a public support. But you have to do it, you have to help yourself first, and you know. And there might be a possibility at the last stage that my government might help do something, but don't rely on this one. So which means that's their, you know, government getting the tax and, you know, leaving the politicians living with the tax money, telling them you have to help yourself. This is the kind of government Suga is forming. And with my opinion, Suga is much, much more right-winger than Abe. I thought Abe was bad, but no. Suga is worse than Abe.
You're right. I agree with you.
And on the contaminated water. Okay, water itself is in a certain area, one particular area within the land of the power plant. However, we are so, you know, filled no more. We can't hold it. We have to release it. Now, water has, they said what's called decontaminated. Still, you know, tritium cannot be, no way, they admit they cannot take out from water, those water. So it's tritium is still there, and probably others too, but the main thing is apparently tritium. That if they want to release it into the ocean, which, first of all, Korea, South Korea is so strongly opposed that has the closest one. And I don't know how they can release the water without, you know, taking out the tritium, which they cannot take out tritium, which means the only solution is just keep building the tanks to hold it. And that's all, no solution.
Yeah, quickly, okay, thank you. Let me talk. As you mentioned that JOC, both JOC and IOC had received 100 millions of broadcasting right paid by NBC network. And that money already they've been used. So then they have no excuse how much money they had spent already, and they cannot cancel of their broadcasting right because they spend them all and it's gone already. That's one comment. Second comment, as Steve mentioned to me at the end of my presentation, and you brought up the name of Richard Armitage. So I know him. He published Armitage Report, Armitage and Nye Report. Nye is Joseph Nye, a Harvard University professor. They published a report, a textbook, once a year. And they try to educate the Japanese technocrat and LDP. Soon after they receive each year, the report has translated into Japanese right away, and they become very popular textbook to teach the government and the technocrats and politicians how they should act next year, next following year. So the actual person who controls Japanese politics is Joseph Nye and Richard Armitage. So thank you for bringing up their name. That's all. Thank you for everybody.
Well, I want to thank all of you for joining us on this. Oh, George, last comment.
No, just Sayonara.
Sayonara.
Okay, well, I want to thank you all for joining us. Follow No Nukes Action and other activities. And thank you all for participating in the panel. We have to build solidarity. We have to build education. And this is part of our education process. So I want to thank you all for joining us this evening, and my host, Akuru, and others, all the panelists. So thank you very much. Solidarity International.
Thank you. Thanks. Bye-bye.